So, welcome to the lecture, Applied Mathematical Finance, or Computational Finance too. Today I like to continue a little bit on calibration, but maybe you can also see it as an independent section or session. I would like to present the Leeuwenberg-Marquardt optimizer. Well, and calibration is maybe motivation. So we are in this section on term structure models. So we have a very big, complicated model, and the model has a huge number of free parameters. Well, here it's maybe n functions. If you use the functions as a piecewise constant, then you have a lot of parameters, say 100 parameters. You can reduce the number of parameters by using functional forms or coarser discretizations, but to have a good calibration to data, maybe you have to have some, at least some parameters. Speaking of data, the data are the financial products. So in our section on calibration, we saw that we can map these, for example, to a matrix of swaptions, and there are easily 200 or more such financial products to which we like to fit the parameter. So calibration is then to some extent the inversion of the map. Model parameters maps to value of financial product. So this map is a map from Rn to Rm, where usually, I mean, it should be M is much larger than N, or larger. Yeah, so I have more financial products I have to fit to than I have parameters. Otherwise, there would be the risk of overfitting, yeah, or there is a free parameter I can choose independently. This can happen, yeah. For example, like a correlation, yeah, and you don't have a financial product to map it to, yeah. So it can happen also if there are more financial products than parameters, if the financial products do not depend on this parameter. Yeah, so these situations can happen, but usually you have much more products and all parameters can be determined by these. Of course, if you have more if you have more financial products than parameters, you cannot expect to find the exact fit. So in some sense, you like to minimize some norm. Yeah. So given the values of some financial products as a Y, find the best parameter. So find the minimizing parameter X such that some norm is minimized. So this can be some norm here. Yeah. And also the function F, well, you intuitively think this is the valuation of the financial product using the model, but the function f can also include different transformations to other coordinate systems. So the value of f, and hence also the value of y, may be given as values in a currency, so prices, but also implied volatilities or other transformation of the price, of the value. And this transformation is sometimes important because it represents a different weightening of the financial product. For example, if you think of an option on a swap, yeah, say a swaption, this swaption value increases if the length of the swap increases, because you get more payments, and it's just that the swap contains more, yeah, there's a scaling, and the value of the option increases if the option maturity increases, yeah, because an option is an increasing function of the accumulated variance, of the accumulated volatility, and you accumulate more volatility. So this means that prices, values for longer maturity options or swaps with longer swap maturities are larger, and values for these other products are smaller. So if you now optimize just the value, you somewhat favor long maturity products, and the difference on a short maturity product is maybe not so big. But maybe your financial portfolio has much more of the short maturity products, and they are maybe more important to you. If you like to have a weightening that is independent of this maturity, maybe you could switch to volatilities, because the volatility is a single parameter that is in, for example, the Black-Scholes formula or the Bachelier formula, scaled with the option maturity. Okay, so this aspect here represents a kind of weightening of the financial products. Okay, so I like to solve this, and let's discuss one possible numerical algorithm to do this. Well, a popular one, the Levenberg-Marquardt optimizer. So I do this. This is not just a motivation, yeah. So it's very useful also in other situations. So I just like to solve now this, and I would like to solve it for a specific norm, for L2 norm. Yeah. So actually, I'm minimizing the square of f of x minus y. And as some of you might know from what was the section on the Bermudan options, this can be linked to a linear regression. Okay, so let's discuss the Levenberg-Marquardt optimizer. Okay, so our motivation here in our context is the calibration of a model. Calibration of the model tries to determine the parameters of a model as, say, a best fit approximation. So I assume that my inputs are here the model parameters x1 to xn in Rn. Well, I view these parameters as in Rn. Maybe in an application, they come from a certain interval. For example, volatility should be positive, but you can create such constraints, for example, by transformations. But for example, you could use x from R or x1 from R and then take e to the x, and you have transformed the parameter to the domain 0 to infinity. So these are my inputs. My output is the valuation of the financial product. So this is here the FJ. Well, that should be a J. Is this a J? I don't think so. Let's fix the slide. Yeah. So we have the financial product FJ representing the J's calibration product, and this goes from 1 to m. And these can be many, yeah? So m can be 200, n can be 40, 100, or something like that. And the problem we like to solve is here the best fit approximation in L2 norm. So L2 norm is the square root, yeah? but minimizing the square root is the same as minimizing the argument here. So I like to minimize yj minus fj squared, taking the sum over all financial products. So there is another typo here. This slide needs some work. Now, of course, this goes up to m. So over all financial products, I would like to minimize here this distance. Of course, you may consider other norms, but the algorithm is now starting from this. So first, I allow here optimization of a nonlinear function. So f is a nonlinear function inside this norm. So first step is that we consider the approximation of f with a first order approximation. So I approximate the nonlinear function by a linear one. F of x plus delta x is f of x plus the derivative times delta x. Here the derivative is a derivative matrix. Yeah. So this is maybe take some effort to calculate this. Yeah. So this is the matrix dfj by dxi. Okay. So if I use this approximation, the norm that I would like to approximate is S of X. So I would like to minimize the norm that I would like to minimize here is S of X. That can be seen as the norm of Y minus F of X, or the scalar product of Y minus F of X with y minus f of x. Yeah. So this here is just a scalar product. Okay, and if I plug in the approximation, I can view this as a function of x and delta x. So I use here the approximation that f is replaced by this linear function here, and that defines me a function of x and delta x. So the quantity that I like to minimize is here the scalar product or the norm of y minus f of x minus delta x. So it's y minus f of x plus delta x, and I plug this in. And now I like to optimize delta x. So I would like to find the optimal delta x, which is then the optimal step in my iteration of this optimizer. So instead of finding the optimal x, so here find the optimal x that minimizes this quantity, I replace the function by a linear one and like to find the optimal delta x that minimizes here this approximated thing. And that's actually all. Yeah? Well, there is a small another improvement, yeah, but that's actually all. Then you just repeat this. So replace your function with a linear approximation, find the optimal step, move to this point, and repeat everything. Yeah. So you then, of course, approximate the function at the new point. Yeah. So you have to recalculate this y. Yeah. So this j. So this j actually depends, of course, on the point where you are. So the main idea is now to minimize this with respect to delta x. Yeah, so taking delta x as the parameter. Well, I can just differentiate with respect to delta x. So I just differentiate here with respect to delta x and try to find the root. So look for ds tilde by d delta x equals to zero. So differentiating this scalar product gives me two times differentiate the stuff that is inside the scalar product with the and multiplied with the vector itself. So this is, so if you differentiate here this with respect to delta x, it gives me just a j. So it's two times j, yeah, so actually a minus, but okay, there should be a minus, right? Maybe we fix this, yeah? It doesn't matter because I'm setting it equal to zero. So this is minus 2j times y minus f of x minus j delta x should be equal to zero. So if we like to find the minimum of this with respect to delta x, yeah, so minimize this as a function with respect to delta x means set this to zero. So now multiply here the j transposed, yeah, so a scalar product a times b is a transposed times b, yeah, so if I differentiate you get the transposed, of course. So then this means that you have j multiplied with y minus x, so which we have here, j multiplied with y minus x, and j, yeah, j transposed multiplied with minus j delta x. So I have j transposed j delta x, and this should be to equal to zero. So if you move this here to the other side, I have the equation that my optimal value delta x should fulfill j transpose j delta x should be equal to j transpose y minus f of x. And you maybe see that this is just the same as for a linear regression. Now, a linear regression is also just the minimization of the L2 norm. And this here was the matrix where J is formed out of the basis functions, yeah, the explanatory variables in the linear regression. Then we ask ourselves, can we invert this matrix? If you can invert this matrix, J transpose J, if you can invert it, it moves to the other side and you have found the solution. Okay, so m is the vector of parameters. So, delta x is a vector coming from the space of parameters. It's a change of the parameters. So actually delta x here is a parameter in Rn. What was that? Was that Rn? Yes. And m was larger than n, so and n was the smaller one. So, and this here is an n by n matrix. Yeah, so this is actually the smaller matrix. Yeah, m is the larger quantity. So this is a smaller matrix. So if you have, for example, just one parameter, this is just a scalar number and you divide by this. Okay, so we should maybe expect that this matrix is invertible, but it may happen that it is small or it is not invertible. So if this matrix is not invertible, what can we do? There is the so-called Tikhonov regularization. So also in the context of linear regression. And what we do is we add a portion of the identity matrix. So I'm adding here lambda times I. Yeah. So I is the identity. Okay, and we make lambda sufficiently large such that the matrix J transpose J plus lambda I is invertible. So then we can invert this matrix. Okay, so that looks strange, yeah, because that looks as if okay, now I made this matrix invertible, but I'm solving not the original problem. That's a bit strange. Okay, maybe it's nice in a different session, also in the context of linear regression, to visualize a little bit what's happening. So if you find the solution, and there are also alternative regularizations, but now here in this algorithm, yeah, just take this as an idea, and let's see what's happening to our problem, to our algorithm, if we do this. So let me skip this remark. I come back to it later. And so recall our equation, so our problem. So we have J transpose J plus lambda I, well, should be inverted and multiplied with J transpose Y minus F of X. Okay, consider the case where J transpose J is not invertible, for example, the limit case where it is zero. So what do we have here? So then I have lambda multiplied with delta X equals that. So then I have that delta X, my solution here, so then I have that the delta x is 1 divided by lambda j transposed y minus f of x. And you see that this is just the classical gradient descent method where you go in the direction of the gradient. Yeah? So that's just the gradient descent algorithm with a scaling factor. So there is a dampening. So we have a kind of dampening. So if we make lambda large, so lambda large is what we do if J transpose J is not invertible. So if we make lambda large, then 1 divided by lambda will be smaller. So we go in a little bit smaller step in this direction. Maybe you also know this from machine learning, yeah, when you train neural networks, yeah, then you also have a gradient descent algorithm, and there is this dampening parameter that tells you how fast you go in this direction. This is exactly this here. So you see that the limit case where J transpose J is not invertible and we make lambda large is actually a known optimization algorithm. It's just a gradient descent. So by adding this lambda, we didn't make anything worse. Yeah, we just moved to a different algorithm. And if you consider the case when lambda is equal to zero, and J transpose J is invertible, then you see that this is just the classical Newton method. Yeah. So first derivative of F divided by second derivative of F multiplied with Y minus F. Yeah? So that is just a classical Newton step. So you see that here this problem is to some extent an interpolation. So lambda is now my interpolation parameter from zero to say a large value, yeah, is an interpolation of the gradient descent method and the Newton method or Newton-like method. Okay, and that's now the Leben-Berg-Marquardt algorithm. So actually the Leben-Berg algorithm uses here lambda I, and then there was a modification. The Leben-Berg-Marquardt algorithm uses lambda times J transpose J, take the diagonal of this, and also if there is a zero on the diagonal, replace it with a one. Yeah, so it is a small scaling here the modification here is that not all parameters get the same dampening lambda. So the lambda is scaled a little bit by how fast the parameter moves. So that's the algorithm. So I found now my delta x. Yeah. So as the solution of this problem. So my delta x is now, assuming that lambda has been chosen such that the matrix is invertible, then delta x is j transpose j plus lambda I inverse j transpose times y minus f of x. So we found the optimal delta x. Well, not the optimal of the original problem. Yeah, if lambda is not zero, but then it is maybe a good step in the right direction. So we found our delta x. Then we take the new x to be x plus delta x and restart again. So actually what you do in the computer program is you start with some value lambda, you build this matrix, you try to find the inverse. If inversion fails, you increase lambda. Yeah? You increase lambda until the matrix is invertible. But then your algorithm has a quite large lambda, which is a small step size, and the algorithm is becoming slow. So whenever the matrix is invertible, I decrease lambda a little bit to get a larger step to make the algorithm faster. Yeah? So until I hit the bound again that the matrix is maybe not invertible, maybe the matrix is invertible and I can use lambda equal to a very, very small number, yeah, or zero. So that's the algorithm. So the algorithm modifies the lambda, adapts the lambda in each iteration step. So the algorithm adapts lambda in each iteration step. So if the matrix is invertible and the new one is an improvement, the new value is an improvement, so the step size is not too large, lambda is decreased, and otherwise, if that is not the case, I'm increasing lambda and try again. So of course, in every step, I need to recalculate the matrix J. And this is computationally demanding. Yeah, if I'm minimizing now a problem from Rn to Rm, yeah, I have to calculate n times m derivatives here. Yeah, so maybe the evaluation of the financial products, the m is not so time consuming. But whenever you change a parameter, so whenever you change a parameter out of these n parameters, you have to create a new model. So maybe a new Monte Carlo simulation if you do brute force and have to recalculate the values. So this can be time consuming, and this is maybe where the remarks from my introduction of the last session are relevant. That maybe we would like to reduce the dimension of the problem using bootstrapping. And if we are in one dimension, we can, of course, just use also a different optimizer, to solve this. Okay. So here is the algorithm now on a single slide. So with all the iteration. So I initialize my x value, so my first guess, to some initial value. So there's some initial value here for my x. Then in every iteration, so now I start in iteration step zero, I calculate all my values. So I calculate here the function. Of course, I need it, and all the derivatives. So this is what is costing time. Then I solve the linear problem, or actually I try to solve it with a given lambda. So lambda has been also initialized to some value. I try to solve this to find the delta x. So if this solution exists, if this matrix is invertible, and if the new value is an improvement, it can happen that the step was too large. Yeah. So if you consider the gradient descent, it can happen that your step is too large and the new value is not an improvement. So that is also a criteria to reject the point and to increase the lambda. So, but if it is an improvement, so if the new value gives you a lower norm than the previous value, then you update the value, you make lambda smaller, and you continue at step two. So I continue at step two, so that's the red one. So I recalculate the value and the derivative. If the solution does not exist, so I cannot invert the matrix, I make lambda larger. But of course, also, if the solution exists, but the step size is maybe too large, so if it is not an improvement, I also make lambda larger. So it is a smaller step. It is more gradient descent-like. And then I repeat at number three. So I don't need to recalculate the derivative. So that's nice. I don't need to recalculate the J and I don't need to recalculate the F. I just need to solve the linear problem. So that's not so computationally resource intensive. Okay, so that's the algorithm. So we can have a look at the algorithm. There is one here at some place. There is this optimizer, and it's also used for the calibration of our forward rate model. So of course there are mathematical libraries in the net, in the web. You can find some libraries that also have versions of this. So you find here all this stuff. Yeah. So you find here the parameter lambda, and you find the factor that makes lambda smaller or larger. Yeah. So you can change by what the algorithm is adapting. What you have to plug in is the function. So there is some function here called that values. So this one has to be overwritten if you inherit from this, and it defines the functions. You can also define the derivative. So the J, you can define it. If you don't define it, he will calculate the J using a finite difference approximation. Yeah. So he is performing a finite difference approximation. Of course, this makes the algorithm very slow. If you consider a Monte Carlo evaluation, you have to repeatedly evaluate the function, repeatedly create a new Monte Carlo simulation for every derivative. So calculating this J is quite expensive. And then the loop of this algorithm is here. Yeah. So here is the iteration and here is the loop. So the loop is checking if the new point is an improvement or not. Yeah. So either you see that the lambda is increased, so the point is rejected, or the lambda is decreased, so we move faster or slower. So that's all the technique about the lambda. And this function here, update parameter, is actually solving the linear equation. So here I'm building the matrix J. Yeah, in this algorithm, the matrix is called H and it's called Hessian. I can make a remark on this. And you see here that the matrix is just the matrix of the derivatives. Yeah, J transpose J. So J is the matrix of the derivative. So J transpose J is the I's derivative multiplied with the J's derivative. So that's our matrix. And on the diagonal, so this is the diagonal, we add this lambda, yeah, so plus lambda I. And then we invert this matrix, so we solve the linear equation. So that's all. Okay, so that's the algorithm. So you can find this algorithm here. A small remark. So remark, in some implementations, the matrix J transpose J is called approximation of the Hessian. Yeah, so that would be a second derivative, yeah, the Hessian. And that's maybe a bit confusing. That just depends on how you motivate, how you derive this algorithm. So note here that if you have a function f squared, yeah, so I would like to take a look here at the function f squared, then the first derivative of f squared is 2f times f prime, and differentiating this again gives me 2f prime times f prime plus 2f times f double prime, yeah. And if you like to find the minimum now of f, so if we would like to find, if we like to minimize f, yeah, so here now my y is equal to zero, then this is small, yeah. So we can just approximate the Hessian. Oops. So we can just approximate the Hessian by J transpose J, yeah, by this guy. So maybe I take a different color here. So I can approximate the Hessian with J transpose J. And that's an alternative way to derive this algorithm. And then you can see that this expression J transpose J can be seen as an approximation of the Hessian. And that's maybe sometimes confusing that in some implementations you find that this matrix which we built here is a Hessian approximation. Well, maybe we should write this here with a capital H. Okay, so that was the Liebenberg-Marquardt algorithm.